The Bone Key by Julia Grace. Slam. Ruby woke with a start, nearly knocking her boyfriend out of bed. The room was dark, lit only by the light coming through the window from her neighbor's garage, which he kept on throughout the day and night. It was like a spotlight through their thin curtain. She leaned over to the small nightstand next to her side of the bed and picked up her cell phone, pressing the button to check the time. 4:20, she was immediately angry. Every single night, several times through the dark hours, their neighbor, Michael Croft, would leave his home in one of two vehicles. Regardless of which he used, he slammed the door so hard the windows rattled in Ruby's house. His revved engine roared, the sound of which she had painfully come to associate with his little black Mustang. He backed out and raced down the road. Michael was proud of his Mustang, and Ruby couldn't blame him for it. It was a neat little car. She was surprised he fit in it. He was a large, black, Vietnam vet who kept to himself most of the time. Ruby preferred it that way. She slid out of bed and slunk to the window, pushing the curtain aside just a little and peeking through. Her irritation generally started that way each morning. Her sleep was broken throughout the night from the constant coming and going of the neighbor. Michael was pulling himself out of the small car. It was like an elephant emerging from a small cave. She narrowed her eyes in frustration. She and Jeff would be moving soon, the end of their lease only a few months. She couldn't wait. Ruby let the curtain flap back to its original position and backed away, glancing down at Jeff. He was still sleeping soundly. He could sleep through a bomb. She turned to leave the room. The bathroom was calling her. Once she finished her business, she stood in front of the mirror and gazed at herself. Her strawberry blonde hair was disheveled, cowlicks making strands stick up all around her head in loose curls. It was amusing to her and she giggled, relieved that her irritation upon waking was slipping away. Jeff would be up shortly. She'd noticed over the 2 years they'd lived together that he was often up only a few minutes after her, regardless of the time. It pleased her to know that her leaving the bed prompted him to wake up. She and Jeff had an old married couple relationship. They had come together by accident, when Jeff lost his trailer home to a terrible fire that consumed all of his worldly belongings. She was just his friend at the time and told him he could stay with her until he was back on his feet. Love had grown from the friendship, and now they were a couple. The relationship wasn't ideal, but it was Ruby's opinion that they were meant to be together. She fought hard to keep it that way, despite their arguments and bickering. It was usually about money anyway. Ruby ran her tongue over her teeth and grimaced. She moved to the sink and picked up her toothbrush, glancing only with her eyes when the bedroom door opened across the hall and Jeff came out, running one hand through his messy blonde hair. He ran his eyes up and down her body as he passed behind her to go to the toilet. "Mornin'," he mumbled. "Good morning, babe," Ruby responded quietly. He was always grumpy when he woke up. She knew long drawn-out conversations were not his thing in the morning. She'd grown used to waiting till he had his coffee before she said anything. She giggled to herself as she left the bathroom, thinking, "God forbid I ask him a question. He wouldn't be staying up for long. He would leave the bathroom after a few minutes and go straight back to bed." It never seemed to annoy him when the neighbor woke her up, thereby waking him up, too, when she left the bed. He could fall back to sleep in under 3 minutes. She had timed him once. She moved down the hall and opened the door to her office. It was on the same side as her bedroom, so she always knew when the neighbor was coming or going. She sat behind her desk and pushed the rolling chair away so she could lift her legs and set them on the corner. Her stomach grumbled. She rolled her eyes. She'd forgotten breakfast. She swung her legs back down and stood up. She didn't leave the office, though. She got to the door and stopped. Something strange was in the air. She lifted her head. An overwhelming feeling of dread surrounded her. And she knew where it was coming from. Seconds later, there was a pounding on the front door so loud it made her jump. She stuck her head out of the office, looking toward the door. Before she could step out into the hallway, though, Jeff emerged from the bedroom. As he passed, he looked over at her, lifting one hand to touch her on the arm. "Stay here. Stay right here." He went down the hall and into the living room to the front door. Ruby watched from behind him, staying in the office, waiting for him to give the all clear. Thoughts ran through her mind. Where was her gun? Where was her baseball bat? What did she have to defend herself should something happen to Jeff? She kept her eyes on the back of Jeff's head as he leaned down and looked through the small portion of the window that wasn't covered by the curtain. He turned back and shook his head at her, waving in a nonchalant way. Ruby pulled in a confused breath and watched as he opened the door. It was the neighbor. Ruby got an instant feeling of disgust. What could the man possibly want with them at 4 in the morning? "Hey, Mike. What's going on?" Jeff's voice sounded as confused as Ruby felt. There was no trace of irritation, though. Ruby thought Michael was lucky she hadn't answered the door. She wouldn't have been so kind. "Hey," the big man's booming voice echoed through the house. The very sound of it annoyed Ruby. Jeff's voice took on a bit of the irritation Ruby was feeling, giving her a sense of satisfaction. "What do you need, Mike?" "I had some steaks in the freezer. I can't find them." Ruby stepped out into the hallway. He had interrupted their sleep at 4 in the morning to tell them he couldn't find his steaks? She frowned but stayed back, lest she let her temper loose. "I'm sorry to hear that," Jeff responded, his voice resuming its former confusion. "You were over there earlier, just wondering if you might know something about it." Anger split through Ruby. She pictured herself taking her baseball bat to the man's head. She wanted to smash it in and dance in the blood. Hatred made her body heat up. "Man, I'm sorry you can't find your steaks, but I don't know anything about it. I wouldn't do that. You should know that by now." "Yeah, yeah," Mike continued to grumble as he turned to leave. Jeff looked back at Ruby with caution in his eyes. He knew her well enough to know exactly what she was thinking. He shook his head and she kept silent. Her hand was gripping the door jamb in an effort to keep herself under control. Jeff was slowly closing the door, murmuring more apologies to Michael as he did so. Ruby didn't have to see him to know the large man was stomping across their yard and rounding the fence into his own. Jeff turned and looked at her. They stared at each other until they heard the door to Michael's house slam. "What is his problem?" Ruby couldn't keep her voice down. "What the hell would make him think you took his steaks?" In her mind, it was completely disrespectful for the neighbor to come over and accuse her boyfriend of stealing something from his house, when they had been friends since the couple had moved in. Jeff shook his head, walking back toward her. "I don't know. He's old. He doesn't remember things. It's not a big deal." Ruby's temper flared. "It isn't a big deal? He wakes me up with that damn door every time he slams it. He revs that damn Mustang as loud as he can pulling out of that garage. The windows rattle. And he accuses you of stealing from him and it's not a big deal?" She clenched her small hands into fists. "It's a big deal to me. I can't stand that man. How dare he accuse you of stealing?" Jeff shook his head again and as he passed, he put one hand on her shoulder, leaned over and kissed her forehead. "Go back to sleep, honey. Don't worry about him. He's just a lonely old man." There was no way Ruby was going to get back to sleep. She turned away from Jeff, who continued down the hall to the bedroom and disappeared behind the door. It took all Ruby had not to slam her office door. She had placed a large cushion love seat near her window when they had moved in. She went to it and knelt on it backwards, pushing aside the curtain enough to gaze with hatred at the house next door. She couldn't help sneering in disgust. Her anger would seethe throughout the day. She would be lucky if she got any more sleep at all. Suddenly, the garage light turned out. Ruby narrowed her eyes, pulling her brows together. She'd never seen that light go out. Not once. Her eyes moved to the basement windows of the neighbor's house. It looked like Michael was going through the rooms down there with a flashlight. A breaker must have blown, Ruby thought. She kept watching until she saw the flashlight wave frantically, the light bobbing up and down. Confusion filled her again. What in God's name was he doing down there? Ruby pulled back from the window and drew in a sharp, deep breath. She wanted to know what was going on. She was going to find out. Before leaving the house, she dressed in black clothes and donned her boyfriend's black knit hat, stuffing her blonde hair up inside it. She went past the bedroom door as quietly as she could and gently pulled open the basement door. A cold winter breeze blew past her. Their basement often flooded and they had a dehumidifier at the bottom of the steps that constantly blew out cold air. She went down as quickly as she could, passing the dehumidifier with a grimace when the air hit her full blast. Ruby rounded the steps and moved past the washer and dryer to get to the door that led outside. As quietly as she could, she crossed the backyard to the alleyway and climbed the fence, dropping down just behind the garage in the ankle-high grass. Her shoes padded softly as she crouched down and moved across the yard. She pressed her back against the outside wall of the garage and skulked toward the house. She could see the basement door in the light of the moon and the other neighbors' backyards. It was likely locked. She hadn't planned on going in that way, anyway. She knew one of his windows was cracked open, regardless of the weather outside. She was a small woman. She would fit through the window. When she got to the window, she knelt down in the grass and peeked around to see what was inside. The flashlight lay on the floor. It shone onto a stack of cardboard boxes and totes. Ruby could see a tall set of metal shelves filled with jars. The jars had liquid in them and something floated in each one. Ruby put her fingers in the crack of the window and pushed gently. The window swung down, as if the hinges had just been oiled. She was amazed at how easy it was. Slowly, she stepped through the window, feeling below it for anything she could stand on. Her foot touched something solid and she gently slid through, hoping whatever she was stepping on wasn't another cardboard box. She was small, but she was at least 120 pounds. She'd go right through cardboard. Pulling in her breath and holding it, she dropped down and realized she had come down on a large rectangle freezer. She froze in place, hearing the sound of muffled voices. She crouched down again, her eyes moving to the flashlight. She picked it up and used it to look around the room. Ruby's heart pounded in her chest as she took the few steps back to the freezer. Her fingers shook as she reached for the latch. Holding her breath, she pulled up the latch and fit her fingers under the lid, dreading what might be in the cold box. Thoughts of Jeffrey Dahmer and other serial killers ran through her mind. She lifted the lid. She moved the flashlight around the contents of the freezer, which was nothing more than frozen meals, ice cream, and various packs of meat. He had plenty of steaks right here. Why would he accuse Jeff of stealing any? She lifted one corner of her lip in disgust. Her dislike for the man had grown to a peak in the 9 months she and Jeff had lived there. He was constantly bothering them about something, sometimes taking Jeff off on road trips where they would do nothing but drink and God knew what else. She turned away from the freezer, closing the lid as quietly as she'd opened it. She tiptoed across the room to the metal shelves and flashed the light at them, gazing at the contents of the jars. It just looked like blobs of goo to her. She was reminded of lava lamps. She swung the light from one to another but didn't recognize anything in the jars. If it were human body parts, she couldn't tell. Her skin tingled with disgust and anticipation. Whatever was in the jars, she wanted nothing to do with it. A noise behind her made her swing around, pointing the flashlight in front of her. Mike was standing in an open doorway on the other side of the room. He was staring at her with cold, dead eyes. She made sure to point the light directly into his face. "What are you doing here?" His deep voice sounded menacing. Ruby nearly had a heart attack. She hadn't brought a weapon with her. What was wrong with her? "I saw something and thought you might be in danger," she said in a voice as cold as his. She didn't care if he thought she was lying. She didn't care about anything the old man thought. Her rage had filled her to the point where she could barely see. Michael had about 200 pounds on her small stature. He looked surprised when she stepped toward him, unafraid. "You shouldn't be here." He took a step toward her, leaving the door to the other basement room open. Ruby thought her heart might come out of her chest. She gripped the flashlight so tightly, she lost all feeling in that hand. She pictured different ways she could defend herself. Michael didn't seem like the type to call the police on her for trespassing. He was more likely to take care of the problem himself. She wasn't going to let him. He had caused her aggravation for 9 months. It was time to settle the issue once and for all, as far as she was concerned. "You should be afraid, little girl," the big man said, taking a few more steps to close the distance between them. She matched his approach, wondering if it was her last day on Earth. She sent goodbye thoughts to Jeff and her mother and brothers. She would fight this man and most likely lose. But she would fight. "I want to know what's going on down here," she said firmly. "What goes on in my basement has nothing to do with you," Michael replied. "Not your business. But now that you're here, I don't see why you can't be in on it." Ruby narrowed her eyes, her heart still thumping, her blood racing. "What do you mean, in on it?" Michael turned to the side and held his hand out toward the room he'd just come from. Blood was rushing through Ruby's head, making her ears ring. It sounded like ocean waves in her head. Her eyes moved to the open door. She looked back at him, shaking her head. I'm not going in that room. I'm afraid you are. You came here on your own. Jeff don't even know you're here, does he? He would have stopped you. That means no one knows you're here. You can't get out. You won't get out. Ruby inhaled sharply, taking a step back from him. It was as though she suddenly realized her vulnerability. Michael smiled at her, sending a wave of terror through her body. She looked around frantically, waving the flashlight toward the basement door and the stairs. Going to the door instead of the stairs would require getting closer to him, so she took off toward them. She could hear Michael's big boots as he chased her. Her heart pounded. She grabbed the railing and yanked herself up. Ruby got to the middle of the stairs when she felt his large fingers wrapping around one ankle. She cried out and lost her balance, slamming down hard. She kicked at him, releasing her ankle by some stroke of good luck. Temporarily relieved, feeling a bit more confident, Ruby scrambled up the stairs and through the cracked basement door. She held on to the flashlight, even though the lights were on in the house. Ruby knew the layout, but fear was confusing her. She spun around to slam the door shut just as Michael reached it. She ran down the hall to her right, remembering there was a back door in one of the rooms. Michael came through the basement door with a roar. She squeaked as she flung open one of the doors, praying to God it was the room that had the way out. She'd been freaked out by her neighbor for months now and never tried to find out anything more about it. Why had she decided to start now? Frustration slid through her when she saw it was not the right room. She didn't have time to run to the next one. Michael was right behind her. He grabbed the back of her head, balling up his fist in her hair. He yanked her toward the door, slapping a hand over her mouth when she cried out. Chills ran over her body when he leaned over and murmured in her ear, "You shouldn't have come here, little girl." Ruby reached up with her free hand to slap his grip on her hair but didn't let go of the flashlight. She was useless against his strength. "Let me go." "You're trespassing," Michael growled. "You broke the law. No business be in my house." He began to drag her back down the hall by her hair. She lost her balance and ended up holding on to his arms, walking on her tiptoes so he wouldn't rip the hair from her head. I, shut your mouth, little girl." Michael's voice was menacing. He sounded delighted that she had finally given in to her curiosity. "I always knew you was gonna be trouble. Always peek in, through the windows. Always gettin' in other people's business." Ruby stumbled when Michael shoved her down the stairs, never letting go of her hair. She grabbed the railing again and held on. She tried to resist, but Michael was much stronger than she was. He wasn't going to let her go. I won't come over again," she said, weakly. "I'm sorry, I—" Michael shook her head violently, sharp pain shooting out from where her hair was being yanked. "I said, shut up." He forced her across to the door he had come out of and before she knew it, he had tossed her into the dark room. "Brought something for you," Michael said and slammed the door. She stumbled with the force and fell to her knees, pain splitting through them when they hit the concrete. She listened to the lock turn. Swallowing hard and attempting to gather her courage, Ruby lifted one hand to rub the back of her head, which was now throbbing, and the other to wave the flashlight around the room. Her heart nearly stopped when the light landed on someone, sitting in a corner, legs pulled up to the chest, arms wrapped around legs. Her breathing was shallow and she thought she might faint if she didn't pull herself together. "Hello," she whispered, keeping the light on the person. The man lifted his head and stared at her. Ruby squeaked out a cry of fear. His entire body was a pale ash color. He had no hair. His blue eyes shone so bright, they were like two tiny burning candles. "Who are you?" Ruby never took the light from his face. She could picture him crawling across the room and tearing into her, eating her limbs and her face. She narrowed her eyes, tilting her head to the side. He could see her. She knew he could. But he didn't move. He stayed where he was, sitting there, staring at her. "I'm Ruby." She decided to take a chance that maybe he wasn't going to eat her alive. "What's your name?" It was a shame her voice was so shaky. She wanted to be confident and strong, but the situation had her at the height of anxiety. The man said nothing. He didn't make a move. Ruby crawled a little closer, stopping every few steps, fear overtaking her. When the man made no motion to move at all, she would go a little closer, still shining the light on him. "Are you all right?" she finally said. The question sounded stupid to her. Of course he was not all right. He was wearing no clothes, his bones were sticking out, his hips and ribs obvious even in his sitting position. He had no hair and his head and arms were spotted with tattoos. When she was close enough, she reached out and touched his cheek. He closed his eyes and pulled back from her, turning his head away. When he looked back, she saw fear in his eyes. He was afraid of her? "What are you doing down here?" Ruby whispered. "He's obviously not feeding you. Is he keeping you here?" She watched in horror as the man stretched his mouth open, his jaw hanging down precariously as if it wasn't quite attached correctly. The squeaking in the back of Ruby's throat resumed when she saw into his tongueless mouth. "Oh, my God," she said in a high-pitched, frightened voice. "Oh, my God. What is he doing to you? We have to get out of here." The man shook his head. "You understand me?" He nodded. "I want to help you." Again, he shook his head. "But you're being tortured. I have to get you out of here." When the man finally moved, Ruby scooted back quickly. He reached out to her, his eyes pleading, making her stop where she was and come back to him. She lifted her hand and grasped his fingers. They were cold as ice. "Oh, oh," she moaned, her fear rocketing through her body. She moved closer on her hands and knees until she was close enough to wrap her arms around his thin body and hug him to her. She was close to tears. All she could think of was getting the man out of the neighbor's basement and into a hospital, where he could recover from whatever Michael had done to him. When she pulled away from him, the tears came, streaking down her face. "What has he done to you? What has he done?" The man only stared at her. "I want to help you. I want to get you to a hospital." The man shook his head. Ruby frowned in concern. "What? You don't want to go?" He pointed at himself, shaking his head. He turned his finger around and pointed at her, nodding. "I can't get out. The door is locked." Chills covered her body when a slow grin crossed his face. She lifted her eyebrows. You can get me out of here?" He nodded slowly. "But what about you?" He didn't give her a response to that. She watched as his bony body moved around her. He was like an animal, crawling on all fours, skittering across the floor to the door. She watched in amazement as he dug into a dirt pile near the door, his thin fingers scattering soil all around him. He pushed his hand down into the pile and pulled something out. Ruby moved closer, shining the flashlight on the object in his hand. She gasped, seeing what looked like a filed down bone. Probably a finger. He looked back at her, pointed at her with the bone, and then the door. She looked down at the dismembered finger and then back up into his shining blue eyes. "You made a key?" His grin was wider this time. She could tell his teeth had softened and become brittle. They were cracked, uneven and a yellow-brown color that made her stomach turn. "I want to get you out of here, too. You have to come." He frowned at her, shaking his head vigorously. He jabbed the bone in her direction several times before tossing it so that it landed just in front of her. But he let out a short bark that sent a bolt of fear through her. She scrambled away from him a few feet before stopping to stare at him. She didn't want to leave without him, but she had to see if the door could be opened with the bone key. Ruby crawled to the door and, using her flashlight, pushed the bone into the small hole, turning and twisting it once it was inside until she felt the button lock. She maneuvered the bone so that the lock would pop open. The sound of the lock popping out of place sounded as loud as a gunshot to her. She froze for a moment. She looked back at the man, her heart heavy. "I just can't leave without you," she whispered. The man jerked forward, holding his fingers up like claws, baring his horrid teeth and growling deep in his throat. Ruby cried out, scrambled to her feet and jerked the door open, only to see Michael's huge form heading toward her like a freight train. She screamed and dashed out of the room, hoping to get around him to the window or the door, something that would let her out of the basement. He stepped from left to right, blocking her when she tried to dodge him. "Trying to escape?" Michael laughed loudly. When he was directly in front of her, Ruby crouched down slightly and jumped up as high as she could. At the same time, she swung with both hands as if to box his ears. The flashlight bounced off the large man's thick skull on one side as she slammed the bone key into his temple on the other. He roared in pain and anger, reached out and grabbed her, tossing her as if she were a football against the wall beside the freezer. She lost her breath but struggled to regain it quickly, turning over on her knees and jumping up on the freezer. She could barely see straight. She had her arms through the window, her hands clutching the outside rim when she felt two huge hands wrap around her ankles. Ruby kicked with all her might, trying to free her legs. She screamed as loudly as she could, hoping it would wake up Jeff. The thought that nothing woke her boyfriend up ran through her mind, and she struggled against new tears of anger and fear. "Get off," she screamed. "Get off me." The hands let go. She blinked in surprise. She turned her head to look over her shoulder and watched in complete shock. The man from the other room had sprinted from the doorway and jumped up on Michael's back. He'd wrapped his long, thin arms and legs around Michael and was clawing at the old man's face with his sharp fingernails. He bit into Michael's neck. Michael shrieked. He was spinning in a circle, trying to shake the man off his back. Ruby let go of the window ledge and dropped back down, one foot flat, the other knee down. She held herself steady for a moment, pressing her fingers down on the surface of the freezer. She met eyes with the man from the other room one last time. It was almost as though she could hear his thoughts. He didn't need to speak. She knew what he wanted her to do. She crawled across the top of the freezer to the stacks of boxes and totes. The totes would be strong enough to hold her weight, she was sure of that. She skipped across the top of them to the metal shelves filled with glass jars. She waited until Michael swirled in front of the metal shelves. With all her might, she tipped the shelves, praying they weren't bolted to the ground. To her relief, they weren't. It was adrenaline alone that gave her the strength to topple the shelves, and divine providence that made it land in just the right spot, on top of Michael and the man from the room. One of the jars came down directly on Michael's large head, smashing into large shards that stabbed into his skull. He screamed and reached back with his hands as if he could pull the shards out. Ruby recoiled when a volatile stench filled the room, and the back of Michael's head began to smolder. The man from the room had released himself as soon as the shelves came down and was lying in a crumpled heap under one of the railings. Michael attempted to push himself up but was obviously in too much pain to do it. Ruby sprinted across the room, jumping over the puddles of acid sliding across the concrete floor from the broken jars. She jumped up on the shelves and stomped across them, pushing them harder down on the big man, whose motions were lessening as the moments passed. Her heart slammed in her chest and she was short of breath, running to the basement door. Her fingers fumbled nervously as she undid the lock. She glanced over her shoulder one last time and caught the eyes of the man from the room. He had lifted his head, looking at her over Michael's motionless form. Tears clogged her throat when she saw the slow smile spread across the man's thin face. "I'm sorry," she whispered. "I'm sorry." The sun was rising when Ruby yanked the door open and left the neighbor's house, still clutching the bone key in her hand, the end of it dripping with blood. Next story. The Mort Safe by David Longhorn. Being surrounded by dead people ought to be more fun than this. Miranda dawdled along at the back of the group. She had never thought until now that she might lose interest in graves. She'd been on this tour for what seemed like hours, though according to her phone it was just over 40 minutes. The unseasonably warm September weather was making her sweat under her black clothes, and her feet were hurting in her Doc Marten boots. She wished she'd left off a layer when dressing that morning, maybe shunned her velvet jacket. Global warming hates goths, she thought fretfully. So unfair. "And now," said the guide, "we come to one of Garmath Cemetery's more unusual residents." The guide, a majestic woman with cropped, iron-gray hair, gestured at a badly overgrown plot that at first glance seemed to be enclosed by a small fence. Looking more closely, Miranda realized that the grave was sealed off not only at the sides but also on top. A cage of rusted black metal covered it all. The cage, combined with the unchecked weeds, obscured all but the outline of the tombstone within. Mysterious. Miranda's interest was piqued. Maybe this tour would not entirely suck after all. There was something about the neglected grave. A feeling of delicious doom, of some ancient tragedy. "Cool. This," said the guide, "is the only surviving example of a mort safe in this part of northern England. Some of you may know of mort safes, a rather gruesome detail of our island history. The idea was to make it impossible, or at least difficult, for body snatchers to steal a fresh corpse and whisk it to the medical lecturers at Edinburgh University. It cost quite a bit to put a solid cage around the grave, set nice and deep so it can't be dug out easily. Such was the fear of the body snatchers. Why not just cremate the dead? Asked an older man in a fawn cardigan and rumpled, drawstring-waisted trousers. I mean, if you didn't want their corpse to be stolen? The guide shook her head. Cremation was illegal, at the time. Parliament only permitted it in the late Victorian era. Before then, burial was compulsory, primarily for religious reasons. It was population growth that drove the shift to cremation. The woman turned to indicate the burial plot inside the black iron cage. Now, what makes this one unusual is that we have no knowledge of who was buried here, as all 19th-century parish burial records were destroyed in an air raid in 1941. Nobody has opened the mort safe in living memory, so the weeds have rendered the inscription unreadable. All we can be sure of is that it's roughly 200 years old. Give or take. The guide smiled as the little tour party gathered round to peer at the weedy plot. Most did not seem particularly impressed. Miranda raised her phone to take a picture of the guide standing in front of the caged grave. Things were looking up. Later she would upload the pic to her blog, Lady Doomflower. She was sure her numerous online friends would be interested. She ignored the slight frowns of some of the other folk on the tour. They were mostly oldies, almost all on the wrong side of 50. Some had been amused by Miranda's appearance and she'd even heard one snide comment about her nose ring. Get a life, normals, she'd thought. We can't all be boring and conventional. Some of us are possessed by the spirit of darkness and mystery. Now it so happens that some rather silly people with overactive imaginations, said the guide, with a sidelong glance at Miranda, think these iron cages were put around graves as a vampire control measure, to keep the unquiet dead from roaming. There was a ripple of slightly nervous laughter. Miranda frowned. She had to put up with enough comments on her lifestyle at work and at home. Can't I just have a nice walk around a graveyard without people making fun? It's not as if I actually believe in vampires. I'd just like to be one, is all. Is that so unreasonable? The truth, of course, the guide went on, is the exact opposite. In the days of widespread body snatching, the relatives of the deceased would pay to protect the mortal remains of their loved ones from the so-called resurrection men, who stole fresh bodies for medical schools. Burke and Hare were of course the most famous of these villains. A middle-aged man in a baseball cap who had already asked a lot of boring questions raised his hand for the 100th time. Miranda heaved a sigh. This was going to take forever. All she'd wanted to hear were some great stories about death, premature burial, maybe a few old-fashioned ghosts. Instead, she was getting a history lesson about old-time funeral customs. Sure, some of it was quite interesting, but there was nothing she couldn't have found on the internet. Is it true that some of these mort safes were booby-trapped? Asked Baseball Cap. Yes, replied the guide. They were indeed. As well as those stout iron bars all around, sunk deep into the earth, sometimes relatives installed vicious spring-loaded man-traps. There were shotguns triggered by tripwires, and even a few small bombs. All of those were dismantled long ago, of course. Now all that remains are these cast iron bars to remind us of less enlightened times. More questions followed. The guide filled in some more details about body snatching before leading the group towards what she described as a fascinating memorial to a local dignitary who was active in education reform. Yeah, right, thought Miranda, hanging back. She lingered by the mort safe and took another couple of pictures at closer range, then decided to write a blog entry straight away. She uploaded the photos. Then on a whim she took a selfie, showing herself crouching in front of the grave giving a peace sign. A bit cheesy, she thought, but what the hell. Miranda stood up, checked to make sure the selfie had uploaded, then looked around for the tour group. They had vanished. She might as well have been alone in the large, neglected cemetery. Now that the guide and rest of the party were out of earshot, the place seemed genuinely eerie, with the breeze rustling the autumn leaves and the sounds of birds calling in the trees. Something rustled behind her and she turned to see movement in the weeds that had flourished inside the mort safe. A squirrel, maybe? Or a rat? Rats did not appeal to Miranda, for all their authentic Gothic overtones. She set off in search of the guided tour. Her Doc Martens seemed suddenly noisy on the gravel of the pathway. Noise that might attract too much attention, and of the wrong kind. She felt certain that she was being watched. I'm not scurrying, she told herself. Not running at all. Just walking. Briskly. A few hours later, Miranda was in her bedroom checking her blog. Sometimes phone uploads went wrong, but her post on the cemetery tour seemed okay. She scrolled down to see if there were any comments. Sure enough, a few faithful readers had responded. Almost all of them were her friends. Cool. You get to go to all the fun places. Wow, those Victorians were weird. Lady D, you look HAWT. Hey Mary, who's your little fiend? Ghost, maybe? Spooky. The last one made Miranda frown. The sender was Gargoyle666, her on-off boyfriend Gary. He wasn't the sharpest knife in the drawer, and sometimes his comments were a bit dopey. She looked back at the blog post, trying to see what he was talking about. At first, she saw nothing unusual about the dozen or so pics she'd taken during the tour. But then she realized that the very last one, her selfie by the mort safe, did have something odd about it. There she was, squatting by the untidy grave, leaning into the shot in a typical pose. Most of the image was taken up with Miranda, in fact, and the grave behind her was slightly out of focus. But Gary had been right, there was a pale, open-mouthed face looking over her shoulder. No, she thought, after a moment's closer scrutiny, it's not a face really. It's just a trick of light and shade, the sunlight through the trees playing on the dense weeds and grass. Miranda racked her brains for the scientific term that described the effect, when someone saw Jesus in a bun or John Lennon in a slice of toast. After a bit of searching she found it. Pareidolia. She typed the word triumphantly into her reply to Gary with a brief explanation of the term, cut and pasted from Wikipedia. She felt highly intellectual, an authority on strange phenomena. Then she decided to add, playfully or at least, that's what I'm telling myself it must be. She was about to close her laptop and go downstairs for tea, but her eyes were drawn back to the selfie. It looked weird, that was for sure. The face created by the interplay of sunshine and shadow was ghost-like. It consisted of a patch of pale green-yellow with shadows marking eyes and mouth. The mouth, if she let her imagination work, was open far too wide. Too wide to be doing anything other than screaming, perhaps in pain, anguish, despair? She could almost hear the plaintive crying of a lost soul. She had often imagined herself as a tragic heroine from the Georgian era, perhaps being prematurely buried. Leaning back, half closing her eyes, she pictured a splendid bedroom, velvet drapes closed, a few candles casting a dim light over a beautiful feminine form. The girl was dwarfed by the magnificent four-poster bed, her dark hair tumbling over one shoulder, a pale hand clutching a spray of wild flowers. By her side her parents watched anxiously as a doctor, in a powdered wig, took the girl's pulse, then shook his head in puzzlement. I cannot, in all conscience, explain this most pernicious anemia, said the kindly old physician. She has not left this chamber in the last 4 days? No indeed, said the girl's father. And we have made sure she had the broth you recommended, as well as the laudanum to help her sleep. And yet, the doctor mused, it is as if she had been leeched 4 or 5 times a day. So pale. Doctor, the girl's mother pleaded, is there nothing you can do? The doctor merely shook his head, and let go of the girl's hand, which fell back onto the covers. The girl's eyelids flickered, opened. Her eyes were dark, unfocused. Her small, rosebud lips opened. The doctor and parents leaned closer. The tragic heroine was about to speak. My, love, said the girl, weakly. We will, be, as one. A knock at the door brought Miranda back to reality with a jolt. Kylie, love? I'm making tea. It's poached eggs on toast, your favorite. And we can have cheesecake for dessert if you like. Miranda slammed her laptop shut and went to the door, shouting through it, I'm not hungry, Mom. It was a lie, of course, her stomach growling. Oh. Come on, Kylie, said her mother, in her best wheedling voice. You have to eat properly or you'll waste away. Knowing that there was only one way this could end, Miranda opened the door. All right? I'll come down. But stop calling me Kylie, I've changed it by deed poll. Her mother made a clucking sound as she preceded Miranda down the stairs. You'll always be my little Kylie, she said, that's all there is to it. Miranda stumped to the dining table, sat down, and took out her phone. Clucking in disapproval again, her mother went into the kitchen. In the 30-odd seconds it had taken them to get downstairs, another comment had appeared on Miranda's cemetery blog post. It was from Trixie 1965 and contained a link accompanied by the phrase, "Beware. See here." Miranda clicked the link and found herself on a local history website. It was run by old folk, judging by its lurid colors, clunky design, and crazy font choices, including lots of Comic Sans. "The 21st century never began for some people," she sighed. "I wish you'd stop staring at your phone for 5 minutes and just talk to me, love," said her mother, putting down plates and taking a seat opposite Miranda. "And you don't have to roll your eyes like that. You're 25, Kylie Sprague, not 15. Mom, it's for my blog, I've got to keep an online presence. If I've got no followers or commenters, I might as well be dead. Especially with the Dracula Festival coming up. For shame, talking like that. In my day we had real friends. We went on picnics, and had fun on the beach making sandcastles, played games, went cycling of course, then there was camping." Thanks to years of practice, Miranda screened out her mother's rambling nostalgia and, scooping eggs into her mouth with one hand, navigated the clunky Garmath history site. There was something about the municipal cemetery, but it seemed too dull to merit that dramatic "beware." She scrolled down, searching for anything about the mort safe. Sure enough, there was. "The grave is supposed to be that of a young woman who died in mysterious, some say tragic, circumstances. While records are lost, local legend claims that the ghost of the woman sometimes roams the cemetery. However, sightings are poorly documented. The only evidence for the so-called ghost is a photograph taken in 1921. Miranda scrolled down again to see a blurred black and white image. It showed three people in old-style clothing standing on front of the mort-safe grave. She brought the phone closer to her face. Between the heads of two of the figures on the picture was something very like the face in her selfie. The same blank eyes, the same wide-open mouth. "No, it's just a coincidence," said Miranda, a forkful of eggs suspended in mid-air. "You'll ruin your eyes, staring at that thing," admonished her mother. "Then you'll have to wear glasses and that'll clash with all your eye makeup." Miranda put her phone down and ducked into her meal, but the thought of the maybe ghost possessed her. Could it be true? Could I have encountered a spirit and not even known it? Perhaps I was too keen on taking a selfie to simply look behind me and see. "What? You're dripping egg on your bodice, Kylie," warned her mother. "I've told you before, I'm not hand-washing velvet again." Miranda glowered at her mother, then stumped off up to lie on her bed, hoping to dream of a better, darker world. In the dream, Miranda was lying on the vast, luxurious four-poster bed, feeling deliciously powerless. Her lack of energy, far from distressing her, seemed to represent a glorious sacrifice. She could not quite remember how the malaise had begun, only that it had its origin in the most glorious of sensual pleasures. She saw, through a haze of sinful joy, the face of a lover. He came closer, his eyes burning with desire. She felt a brief, sharp pain above her left breast, arched her back in ecstasy. There was a metallic clang, a spate of muffled cursing. Miranda was no longer sprawled in the vast, warm bed, but instead found herself in total darkness. She was bound in some kind of cloth that made it hard to move her arms. There was a smell of mold, damp, an all-pervading chill. Tearing through her bindings, she reached out, only for her hands to touch a hard, cold barrier. She reached up to find an obstruction just above her. Her feeling of serene joy evaporated, and she began to panic. "Where am I?" Then she remembered. She recalled the long, slow decline, the physician's attempts to cure her, the tears and prayers of her parents, her brothers, the servants. With the supposed illness came the nameless lover, the one who had materialized from the moonlight, shared her bed, and mixed their blood until she became as he had been for centuries. "We will be together forever, my love." The promise was the best of betrothals, a contract for eternity. But then the monster arrived. She heard an argument outside her door, the family doctor protesting, outraged. It was the last time she heard the doctor's voice. The door opened and her father entered, followed by a musty old man carrying books and a black leather case. She watched him from hooded eyelids as he approached her, peered down at her as if she were a specimen in some museum. "This is no normal illness." The words were spoken in some barbarous, foreign accent. The old man spoke to her father, keeping his voice low. Then her father rushed out and she heard him giving orders. Soon servants were bringing great wreaths of white wildflowers that reeked, their smell so foul that she felt she would choke. She tried to rise from her sick bed, crawl away from the stench. But the horrible old man told two stout maidservants to hold her down. "We must protect her from the creature. It may already be too late." It was too late, she knew that without thinking. The vile intruder discovered this when he tried to put something around her neck. When she saw that it was a crucifix, she screamed, struggled, kicked out, catching one maid in the stomach. The metal cross brushed her face and seared the flesh, burning like a white-hot blade. She screamed and cursed. They tied her down, eventually, and the monstrous old man withdrew to talk to her father. Again, there were loud voices in the corridor, but this time it was her father's voice that was raised in protest. "No. No, you will not do that to my child." The high, cracked voice of the old man was insistent. "She cannot be allowed to roam. You must find some way. Not the stake. That is obscene." There was a pause, then the old man spoke in a more conciliatory tone. "Cold iron, that is one possibility." There was another metallic clang, more swearing, very muffled but still perceptible. Miranda realized that the sounds were coming directly above her. The nature of her confinement suddenly became obvious. But instead of being terrified, she felt an odd sense of liberation. There was a burden, something pressing down on her far more powerfully than 6 feet of dirt. But it was weakening, this oppressive force. Someone was taking it away. She began to scrabble at the wooden lid of her coffin. It was already badly rotted and quickly disintegrated, bringing a torrent of cold earth down upon her. It was then that she noticed she did not need to breathe. She expected to feel revulsion at being enveloped in wormy loam, but it held no terrors for her. What she did feel was a sudden, overbearing hunger. "Are you sure people will pay for this?" The voice was coming through 2 yards of soil, but she heard the words clearly enough. The reply came quickly. "Yeah, marble like this, worth a fortune. Most of these tombstones are just granite, but this is top quality stuff. Somebody will want this in the bathroom, after we pare it down a bit." She recognized the second voice. It was that of a rat-like young man who had been on the guided tour. And he had asked an odd question, she recalled, about whether people, in the olden days, were buried with jewelry. He had been disappointed when the guide had pointed out that they were in England, not Egypt. "What about the inscription, though?" asked the first voice. "It's nearly worn away," said Ratface. "Easily get rid of that. Come on, lift it onto the barrow. Lives as brief and futile as those of crawling bugs." Mia Ketel. She thought of the men's throats, rich with pulsing blood. She could already taste the gushing warmth, feel the energy coursing through her. She reached up with long, strong nails and began to scrabble at the soil. As she dug her way toward the surface, she felt the last rags of her shroud fall away, felt the wonderful chill of the living earth against her naked flesh. Tiny creatures crawled, and she felt their tiny lives, the pulsing of vitality in ephemeral bodies. A lesser being might have devoured them to slake their hunger. But she was ready for bigger game. "I will kill the first man quickly," the rat-faced one. "The other sounds sturdier, more vigorous. Him I will take my pleasure with, for a short while. And if he runs from me, it will be all the more enjoyable." There was another clang, followed by a metallic wrenching noise, another volley of cursing. "Bugger, now I've cut my bloody hand." She felt the rich, carmine drops fall onto her grave. With their impact, the last vestige of her strange bonds fell away. The curse of iron, the devil's enemy, was lifted. She smiled as she swam up towards her prey, feeling like a pale, wondrous mermaid surfacing in an ocean of graveyard dirt. When she clawed her way to the surface, she gasped in delight. The night was as bright as day. A thin sliver of moon provided more than enough light for what she had to do. "What the bloody hell is that?" shouted Ratface. The other one tried to hit her with a shovel, but she caught it easily, and snapped it in two. She noted that mere mortals seemed to move in slow motion, clumsy and hopeless as insects floundering in treacle. She, by contrast, could stride, run, and leap with graceful ease. After so long confinement, action was intoxicating, violence a heady brew. The first chase lasted mere seconds, and slaked her immediate needs. It was quite funny the way the rat-faced man squawked in terror, pleaded for mercy, then simply cried for help before she ripped out his throat. The second mortal lasted a little longer. Her intuition had been right about Ratface's friend. He was a stocky, muscular man, possibly a man to be feared. He was not built for speed, however, and in the minute or so it took her to consume the first course, the second had not run far. This time she lingered over the repast, toying with her food. She left him clinging to the cemetery gates. His screams had been longer, more satisfying, as she had worked her way up his body towards the magnificent, thick artery in his neck. Miranda awoke, then, licking her lips. "Now that's more like it," she said to herself in the dark. The next morning, Miranda could not recall details of the dream, only that it was strange and wonderful. Despite waking with a smile, however, she felt weak, confused, and decided to call in sick. Her manager told her that it was the last time she could pull that one. Her mother was already bustling around before going to her part-time job. "You having one of your funny turns, Kylie?" her mother asked as she bustled around getting dressed. "You have a nice lie down. I'll make you some proper soup with dumplings when I get back from work." Miranda did not even have the energy to object to the use of her old name. Instead, she sprawled on the sofa watching daytime television. On a talk show, a very large woman was explaining that her wanting to have sex with her mother's boyfriend might help bring the family closer together. "Everybody has a better sex life than me," Miranda moaned. "Even people the size of small airships. So not fair." The thought of sex triggered a flashback to her dream. She smelled damp earth, the tang of fear, the iron flavor of blood. The memory vanished as quickly as it had come. Miranda tried to recapture the feel of the dream, but all she could summon up were haphazard images: a bed. An evil old man. A terrible pain, burning, on my face. Miranda put a hand to her cheek and felt what seemed like a cluster of zits developing. "Great. That's all I need, an outbreak of pizza face." Eventually she felt so bored with other people's idiotic lives she flicked over to the local news. She hoped to see that the autumn weather was finally going to become properly cold and damp. She turned on halfway through a news bulletin about mysterious deaths in the old cemetery. Gang conflict of some kind was suspected, and police were making the usual appeals for information. Miranda smiled to herself, then wondered why the story gave her a thrill of pleasure. She frowned, trying to recall the details of last night's dream. It had been about the guided tour, she vaguely recalled. Coincidence. She mooched around all day, spending most of her time on social media, blogging and commenting. The pictures from the graveyard tour had attracted some more interest. But again, there was a weird comment, this time from Wonderpants97. "Where did she go? Came here for a spook, found nothing but a fat goth idiot," she growled, scrolling up to look at the selfie with the ghost-like image. Except that it wasn't there anymore. The random splashes of September sunlight on leaves now looked like just that. The only face in the picture was Miranda's. Bugger. Now the entire comment thread looked absurd, as if she and quite a few other people were on drugs. She began to comment that the picture must have been altered somehow, changed her mind, then posted the claim anyway. She half believed it. Perhaps there was something strange and occult about the image. Wow, that would be great. For the first time, something would have happened in real life that matched her dark imaginings. Of course, the police were probably right. Some thugs were killed by some other thugs. Yet even as she reached that conclusion, Miranda felt again the tug of half-hidden memories. She had dreamed about the graveyard, she felt sure. That night, as she lay in bed, she wondered if she had had too much of her mother's soup. She had not enjoyed it, forcing it down after the first few mouthfuls, leaving the bowl half full. "Upset tummy," her mother had said, and tutted. "Well, that's not surprising, all that horror stuff, it's enough to turn anyone's stomach." Miranda had snorted derisively at the idea. But whatever the reason, she could not get to sleep. Instead, she lay on her side peering at the rectangle of the window, where the thin curtains were illuminated by the street lamps and the lights of passing cars. "Got to get some shut-eye." She closed her eyes firmly and tried to count sheep. It was a silly, old-fashioned trick, but she recalled that it had worked when she was a little girl. At first the plan seemed to be working. She visualized woolly, bouncy sheep leaping over a gate, counted them as they flew comically over into the next field. But then something went wrong. The change happened without her noticing, but suddenly the sheep had human faces. They were people she knew, her stupid boss, Gary, her mother, the snide woman in the corner shop who shortchanged her and then lied about it. The field the sheep were jumping into changed, too. It became darker, as if a cloud had passed in front of the sun. And, oddest of all, no matter how many sheep leaped over, the number in the dark field never seemed to increase. When the bleeding animal with her mother's face made the jump, she opened her eyes quickly. "Bugger," she hissed. "I've lost count." A shadow passed over the window. She heard a light thud followed by a scratching sound on the flat roof of her loft room. Seagulls sometimes flew inland and made nuisances of themselves. Surely seagulls don't fly at night? The scratching continued for a few minutes. Then an ambulance went past, siren screaming, and when the racket died down, there was silence. Miranda felt slightly disappointed. She drifted off to sleep again, but this time no dreams came. The following morning the pimples on her face formed the rough shape of a cross. She covered the blemish with makeup and went to work. After a few days, the mark faded, but the taste of the dream lingered. Whitby was full of goths. Black-clad figures of all shapes and sizes roamed the picturesque seaside town, swarming over sites where scenes from the original Dracula story took place. Some focused on the spot by the harbor where the Count, in the form of a huge hound, had leaped ashore when the death ship Demeter ran aground. A Doberman pincher was encouraged to leap from a small boat by amateur reenactors, but seemed unwilling to get its paws wet. Other cosplayers posed for pictures in the graveyard or on the steps up to the ancient abbey. Confused but excited Chinese tourists took pictures, recorded videos, and ate fish and chips. A veteran of the Halloween festival, Miranda tended to shun the more obvious tourist traps, like the clifftop cemetery where the Count first drank the blood of the beautiful heiress Lucy Westenra. There were subtle gradations within the broader goth tribe, and showing too much enthusiasm for the obvious was a classic sign of the newbie. In practice, this more sophisticated approach meant Miranda and her pal spent a lot of time in pubs. On this particular weekend, Miranda was even keener than usual to keep undercover, as the sun seemed especially fierce. When she remarked on this, she got some odd looks. People also remarked that she had lost weight. "Oh," she said casually, "I've just not been eating so much. Maybe I've gone off food." It was taken as a joke, but as soon as she said the words, Miranda realized that it was true. None of the things that had once tempted her mattered much now. She had not eaten chocolate in weeks. The favorite waterhole of Miranda's circle stood on the headland overlooking the harbor. There they ate cheaply, drank local real ale, caught up on gossip, and sometimes held informal readings of classic stories and poems. Inevitably, those bitten by the literary bug would bring their own fiction. On this particular night, Gary was finishing a story in which a race of subterranean vampires preyed on unwary travelers in the London underground system. It was fairly terrible, but Miranda joined in the desultory applause. It was her turn next. "I would like," she announced, "to read an extract from my epic verse cycle entitled, The Midnight Chronicles of Lady Doomflower." Miranda tried to ignore a flurry of groans, muted giggles, and sighs as she launched into the climactic verses from Book 4, wrapped in the ebony wings of desire. "On moonlit nights we drift amid the tombstones where the dead are hid, my lover from the ancient times, summoned by the midnight chimes." There was a crash of shattering glass from behind the bar. Everyone looked round, some swearing in shock. A young barman was looking sheepish. His manager, a stocky woman with purple hair and an elaborate sleeve tattoo, ordered him to clear up the mess. "And try not to cut yourself," she added, "you'll only excite the vampires." "Sorry," Miranda heard the barman say to his boss. "I should be used to them pranking us by now." The woman said something, a question Miranda did not catch. The barman replied with a rueful smile and gestured at a window that looked out over the harbor. "Whoever it was," the barman said, "her makeup was good. And somebody must have lifted her up, looked like she was hovering." Miranda resumed her reading, but the atmosphere had been lost. Then she reached the lines, "I suffer such appalling pangs while waiting for my lover's fangs." The outburst of titters at this heartfelt couplet convinced her to quit, and she spent the rest of the evening drinking heavily. At first, she devoted herself to making passive-aggressive remarks about the weight, dress sense, and makeup of other girls. After a while, though, the beer cheered her up. Miranda became silly and somehow ended up sliding under a table while attempting to thinking of a rhyme for ghoulies. She staggered out of the pub at closing time, convinced that her poetic genius was simply too elevated for the mundane intellects of, well, just about everyone. She tried to explain this to Gary, who did not respond with any supportive remarks. Instead, he wandered off to throw up in a hedge while Miranda waited outside the pub for him to finish heaving. During this hiatus, she ran over her drink-fuddled recollection of the poetry reading again and recalled the barman's clumsiness. Silly bugger, how could anyone be startled by someone in vampire makeup with fake fangs when the town is full of M? Miranda looked up. The barman had been right, the window where he had seen the face that startled him was at least 6 feet above the ground. Somebody, she fuzzily concluded, had lifted up a lightweight goth who had leered through the window. She wondered if Gary could lift her up, then decided that he was far too weedy. "I am bloody well not weedy," he slurred drunkenly from behind her. "It's the sheer mass of your fat arse that's the problem." "Weedy." Miranda spun round, confused and angry. She realized that she must have been speaking her thoughts, a common problem when she had had a few beers. "What?" she spluttered. "How dare you? You vulgar, crass, rude, unchivalrous, unchivalrous." Miranda struggled for a suitably high-flown word to end her tirade, could not think of one, and settled for arsehole. Gary peered at her in the gloom, tried to draw himself up to his full height, and nearly fell over backwards. Then he pointed and gave a gurgling laugh. "While we're on your favorite subject, which is you, your vampire poem was bloody awful," he said. "I'm sick of hearing it, and sick of you, and I'm going back to the B&B to go to bed." "Well, if you think I'm sleeping with you tonight, you've got another thing coming," she bellowed, jabbing a finger in front of his face. "Fine," he said, stalking off up the road back into town. "You can sleep in the bloody graveyard for all I care." Miranda was about to tell him exactly what she thought of him when a strange thought took her. It seemed like a warm night, unseasonably so for October. People in the pub had been talking about it being chilly and damp. Wimps, she thought. I could sleep in the graveyard. She giggled to herself all the way to the entrance, climbed over the gate, and was soon among the tombstones. She found a wooden bench, took off her long black coat, and made a pillow. The sound of the waves carried well at night, and she heard a distant hoot of an owl. A slight mist arose. Perhaps it is a bit chilly, she thought. But I don't feel it. Because we are kindred spirits, said a small, feminine voice. Because we are so alike. Though not as alike as we shall be. Miranda sat up quickly and almost fell off the narrow bench. In the gloom she could just make out a short, slender shape moving toward her. As the figure grew nearer, she saw that it was a young woman with long, dark hair that almost covered her naked body. Oh my God, Miranda breathed. The girl laughed, a musical sound that had an undertone of joyful wickedness. God is not here, she replied. But I am. And so are you. Who are you? Miranda asked. You know already, replied the newcomer. I have been waiting so long for this opportunity. But why did you toy with me? What? Miranda asked stupidly. I could not enter your home without an invitation, the girl explained. But no one needs an invitation to enter the place of the dead. So now I can consummate our love, and we can become one. It was so difficult for me, such tedious centuries of imprisonment. For you, my sister lover, it will be a matter of moments. Miranda tried to get to her feet, but the small woman was far too quick. She felt needle-sharp teeth fastened into her throat. She grabbed the slender creature and tried to shove her away, but the girl just giggled and held on to Miranda with a grip of steel. Don't be afraid, the girl whispered, withdrawing from Miranda's neck and wiping her mouth with the back of one tiny hand. It's your turn now. The girl drew a long nail across her bare chest and then stood, expectant. Miranda felt woozy, no longer in control of herself. She struggled to remember who and where she was, and snatched at a few fragmentary memories of her life. She saw Gary's face, sneering. Her mother, pitying her. Her boss, full of rage and contempt. Her so-called friends, bored by her poetry, her pretensions. Miranda looked at the perfect, ageless being in front of her, and realized that for the first time, she had a chance to embrace darkness in its purest form. Clothes, makeup, boots, all were meaningless next to this. She gulped, bowed her head and licked at the viscous blood oozing from the vampire's pearly skin. And then she felt herself awake from a mundane, disappointing life to something far, far better. Gary fell into a deep, drunken stupor as soon as he got back to the B&B, but he awoke long before dawn, feeling terrible. "Oh, Christ," he moaned. "Miranda? You got any paracetamol?" It was only when he reached out for the reassuring curves of his girlfriend's bum that he remembered their row outside the pub. Groaning some more, he heaved himself out of bed and put on the few items of clothing he had managed to take off earlier. "I can't leave her out there," he thought. "Silly cow, she'll catch pneumonia." After Miranda failed to answer her phone, Gary clattered down the stairs and out into the street. The night was almost wintry, the chill air clouding his breath as he half ran, half staggered out of town. This sobered him almost completely, and he gibbed thanks for the illumination of a gibbous moon. He did not really think she had slept in the graveyard, but it was all he could think of. The clifftop cemetery was fenced off, but it was easy to clamber over. Once in, he began to make his way along the rows of tombstones, wishing he had a flashlight. "Miranda," he shouted. "You in here, love?" He heard a giggle from somewhere up ahead. "Oh, come on," he protested. "Don't play hide and seek. I'm sorry I said those things. I was drunk. I love you really. Come on, girl. It's cold." More giggling, and this time Gary was sure that there were two voices. One was ahead of him, the other behind. It occurred to him for the first time that there might be other people in the graveyard, perhaps couples having a late-night shag. The thought of stumbling over people he knew in the throes of passion made him pause, then turn back toward the entrance. As he did so, a dark-clad figure appeared in his path, its face a pale blur in the darkness. Could be any one of 100 goths, he thought. "Miranda," he asked, stepping closer. "Hello, Gary," she said. He felt a sense of relief, tinged with puzzlement. Her voice seems different. Hollow, in a way. Maybe she has caught a chill. "Miranda, I'm sorry," he said, holding out his hands in a placatory gesture. "Let's get you back to a nice warm bed, eh?" "All right, Gary," she replied gently. "There are plenty of nice places to lie down around here. And it's not as if the night is cold." "What?" he began. She stepped closer and he felt her hand brush his cheek. It felt cold, slightly clammy. Then she gripped his face more tightly. He tried to pull away, but failed. Her other arm snaked around his neck, and she pulled him to her, pressing chilly lips to his. Gary made a tremendous effort and shoved Miranda away. "Ah," she said, in a hurt voice. "Don't you want a nice kiss and cuddle?" "Stop mucking about," he protested. "It's too cold for that." "But I'm so hot," she breathed. "Where it counts." He reeled back as she grabbed him again and pushed him down onto a grave plot. Gary fell heavily and was left gasping for breath. Miranda was tearing at his clothing, making little panting sounds. "What the hell?" he thought. "If she's that Randy, I might as well lie back and enjoy it." Miranda began to nibble at his chest, then he felt her teeth fasten on his left nipple. He was about to give her some encouragement when she bit deep, and a searing pain shot through his chest. He punched her in the side of the head and kicked out, roaring with pain. Miranda sat up, her mouth dribbling blood that was black in the moonlight. "Don't be like that," she said, her voice muffled. "We're just getting started." Then she raised a pale arm and shoved Gary back down so hard that he struck his head against the side of a gravestone. The blow left him dizzy, and he tried to crawl away. But in front of him he saw a pair of small, white feet. Looking up, he saw a naked girl gazing down at him, her mane of black hair stirring in the clifftop breeze. "Oh, Miranda," said the stranger. "You started without me. How naughty." Gary got to his feet and tried to run past the naked girl. She stood, smiling sweetly, as he lumbered along the path towards the entrance. He felt warm blood coursing down his chest and into his half-undone pants. "Let's give him a start, darling," he heard the naked girl say. "It's only fair. Count to 10. Wondering if he was in a nightmare, he heard two voices start to count. Their voices faded as he staggered towards the gate, the entrance looming up. He turned aside to climb over the fence, which was the lesser obstacle. As he scrambled to grip the clammy iron railings, the last, rational part of his mind told him that they must have reached 10 by now. And then they were on him.